Barrett Sallee, we're going to serve you some crow with some store-brand ketchup today, my friend. Store-brand ketchup, not even the real stuff.
Well, I'm not even a ketchup guy, Ryan, so that's just insulting. But I probably deserve it after that.
All right. So, all right, let me ask you this. What's the craziest thing that you read on Twitter as people were aggravating you about that win in Oxford?
I honestly didn't read a ton of it because there was too much of it. I was watching the Ohio State TCU game at the same time. So I didn't read a ton of it. I tried to respond as many people as possible. So mostly just you're a moron, you're an idiot, you lose your credibility. Most of the time credibility was spelled creditably, which is not correct. But, you know, most of that stuff. The worst one was somebody said that I use my epilepsy and seizures as a cop-out because I, you know, or something like that to have bad picks, which is just ridiculous. But, you know, nothing too bad. You know, I've had a lot worse in the past with several fan bases. So it wasn't too bad.
All right, let me ask you, just how big of a surprise was it that Alabama performed this great, or maybe Ole Miss didn't perform up to maybe what the expectations were going in that game? Maybe just help us analyze that game from your perspective.
Yeah, I mean, I thought the defensive backs were going to struggle more. Really, the first play of the game, I thought you'd see a lot of that. A lot of busted coverages, a lot of big plays in Ole Miss's offense and in the passing game. So I thought you'd see a lot of that because I just thought it was going to be a matchup problem. New secondary, road atmosphere, game three against, you know, theoretically some of the best receivers in the country, and I still think they are. But it got sideways. And I think really at the turnover, I think it was Jordan Thom who turned it over in the first quarter. I think that just it just completely flipped the game. It just got the game completely sideways. I thought Ole Miss still had a chance, like a little bit in the middle of the first quarter. They were confident. But then once some things started going south, they had nothing. The adversity was too much. So, it got sideways. I thought that Alabama secondary, though, would have a little bit less success against those wide receivers.
Baird, is it fair to say that Alabama's secondary, and they've exceeded my expectations because I thought this secondary would struggle when you lose every single member of your secondary and you bring in new coaches and you have new different ways to do things, even though it pretty much stays the same under Nick Saban. You still got a new terminology, philosophy, coaching style, new coordinator. Is it fair to say that this secondary has benefited from going up against Tua Tagovailoa in these wide receivers in practice, that maybe they're prepared for the challenge a little bit more than what we anticipated?
Yeah, I think that's a big part of it because, I mean, we've seen Tua drop dimes consistently. But really, that was sort of the mystery to me, is because Tua didn't play in the spring, right? So really, all of that happened in fall camp. So, I think that's fair because Tua just doesn't put it on the doorknob. Tua puts it in the keyhole. I mean, that's how accurate he is. So, if the secondary has to deal with that on an everyday basis, then I think that's going to be a huge benefit to them because they're not going to see that. I mean, you're not going to see, you know, quarterback accuracy like that outside of maybe, you know, one or two other guys in college football, and that might even be a little generous. So, yeah, certainly that's a benefit. I think they that's been a big part of their success, and I think a big reason why what they saw Saturday night in Oxford, wasn't that big of a deal to them, because I still think Jordan Thom is a good quarterback. I think he had obviously a bad night, but I still think he's a good quarterback. And I think what you can't have if you're a team playing in Alabama is a guy who is just a little bit erratic, because Alabama's secondary can handle that. That you need to have somebody a lot like Tua to even have a chance, and there aren't many guys like Tua.
We're talking to Barrett Sallee right now, CBS Sports National College Football Analyst, ESPNU on SiriusXM, as we continue talking about the Alabama game. Alabama able to get that win 62-7. Barrett, how much more is there to the ceiling of this offense? Because really, we've only seen the starting offense, probably, even if you add it up, probably about six quarters, two in each game, when we talk about the first string offense. How much more is there to go of the ceiling, to reach the ceiling for offensively for Alabama?
Scoring enough points to get out after one quarter? I mean, that's probably it.
That's a great point. Great point. Excellent.
I think this is, I mean, this is the best offense Alabama's ever had. I don't think there's any doubt about that right now. I don't know how much higher the ceiling can get from that. Best offense of all time. I think with Alabama, I even said this last night on CBS Sports HQ, we were talking Heisman. And I mean, I said Tua is the front runner. Tua would be my pick right now, but Tua's stats are not going to be Heisman worthy because he's only going to play two quarters per game. So, you know, I think that the ceiling is what it is right now, the best offense in Alabama history. And I mean, I guess theoretically it could be the best offense in college football history, but I just don't see how that's attainable if you don't play the whole game and their offense isn't going to do that.
We're talking right now to Barrett Sallee. Barrett, let's move around a little bit in the SEC. Let's go to LSU and Auburn. Your thoughts as Coach O goes to Lee County and finds a way to get the win?
Yeah, Joe Burrow, I mean, statistics, kind of like against Miami. Statistically, you know, it wasn't that great, but 3rd and 7, that deep out to convert on that final drive, and then 4th and 7 across the middle to convert on that final drive. I think you saw Joe Burrow, you know, go win a game with his arm. And how often have we seen that from an LSU quarterback? I mean, Mettenberger did it a few times in 2013, but really aside from that, you haven't in about a decade. So that was very impressive. I think the thing about that game, and I don't want to sell LSU short because I think they were number 6 or 7 on CBS Sports 129. But I think that game was still sort of played the way they want to play it. You know, Auburn, I think, made a mistake going for it on 4th down in the first quarter, I think that was. And Stidham didn't have his best day, so they couldn't turn the game sideways. I still don't know if LSU can go, you know, toe-to-toe, point-for-point with a great offense. And they're going to have to do that. They're going to have to do it against Georgia, I think. They certainly will have to do it, against Alabama. So, you know, it's very impressive what Joe Burrow did. I still think there are some lingering questions, but it's kind of like what we talked about with Alabama last week. The lingering questions are relative. I mean, you know, Alabama last week, we talked about this. The running game hadn't been going that great, and the kicker hadn't been that great. Those were all ticky-tack things, and I think it's a ticky-tack, indictment of LSU. But, they still have that out there.
And I'm really looking ahead. But I for some reason, let's do it here just for a couple of minutes as we finish up our conversation with Barrett Sallee, CBS Sports National College Football Analyst. LSU, La Tech, forget about that. Ole Miss there in Baton Rouge, I think that's a win.
Yeah.
At Florida, that's a win. Let me go to October the 13th. Can this team improve enough that they can give Georgia a really good game? Because that game is in Baton Rouge, and that's really looking ahead 4 weeks down the road. But you now circle that game because we didn't in the offseason.
No, we didn't. And, I mean, I would imagine that I'm not spilling any trade secrets coming because we haven't made the selection yet. But, yeah, so it's not going to be at night. But, I think very quiet. Everyone's kind of talking about, Tua. That's not just in your neck of the woods, but everywhere. Kind of has done the same thing as Alabama thus far this year. You know, I mean, Jake Fromm's been awesome. The offense is cranked up. They just flat out play murder ball sometimes. And, I don't, again, sort of one of those things. In Baton Rouge, yeah, LSU's got a chance, a pretty decent chance. But I think Georgia also has the chance to light that scoreboard up a little bit, even against the defenses. So can Joe Burrow go point for point with Jake Fromm? I think it's more likely that he can do that than he can at home than he can against Tua and Alabama, because Alabama's probably better at it. But, that's going to be a pretty balanced, pretty evenly matched game that I think Georgia can still win, but I'm not writing it down in ink like I was this time last week.
It's been a long time since there was a national champion winning coach that's going to be coming into Tuscaloosa and actually playing in front of the Bryant-Denny Stadium inside of a hostile environment at times. Jimbo Fisher brings his Aggies to Tuscaloosa. Any chance this can be a a game. Vegas doesn't think so. Does Barrett Sallee?
Yeah, I'm kind of with Vegas. I like what Jimbo Fisher has done so far. You know, I think Kellen Mond, you know, I don't think Kellen Mond really had that great a day. I mean, some of those passes that he made, the bigger ones especially, were really ill-advised. He just got lucky breaks. I think the big thing is, though, is that he was still pretty composed throughout the entire game against Clemson, which has to be when you're going up against defense like that. So he's going to have to do that again. And the fact that he's done it, at least gives, I think, A&M hope for the future, but not hope for the present in terms of this week. I don't know who on that defense is going to be able to shut down this offense. I don't know if they'll have the depth in the secondary. They've got a decent defensive line, so I guess you kind of look at that and say, okay, Alabama's offensive line up until last week had been good but not great. What does it actually mean? But you'd be searching for mismatches at that point. So I don't think they stand a chance unless, you know, Tua starts turning the ball over every single drive. That's not going to happen. So, I think that's one of those games where, you know, you take the points or you lay the points, whatever you want to do. 28 points is a lot. I wouldn't really want to put money on either one of those sides because I think Alabama can basically stop scoring whenever they want to stop scoring.
Hey, join those 75,000 passionate SEC fans. Connect with Barrett Sallee on the Twitter account. Find him there, cbssports.com. Find him on SiriusXM, college football on Sunday and throughout the week, all over radio stations talking SEC football. As he reminds us, he always likes to write an accountability article in December. And there's not too many journalists out there that do that. Listen, I'm going to give you trouble and grief about that pick, but there's not many because, I could find up a lot of Hurts for Heisman articles here in Tuscaloosa, and people just disregard those. At least you write an accountability article, man, and I appreciate you being part of the show.
Well, I appreciate that, and for those that didn't see it, Alabama Pro Updates said he'd offer $5 for every point over Alabama covering against Ole Miss and donate it to my fundraiser for epilepsy. No, obviously I have epilepsy, so I did that too. I matched his donation in addition to what I've already donated, and people can look at the tweet pinned to the top of my profile, and please donate whatever they want, and let's make some good happen out of my ridiculously dumb old mistake.
Hey, Barrett, I did see that, and we retweeted it, and Alabama Pro Updates, let me just give them guys. Those guys are awesome with keeping up to date. I mean, those guys, and it's good to kind of, you know, put some money in, as you said, make a little positive out of this. Hey, man, thanks for being a good sport. Have a great week. We'll talk to you very soon.
All right, thanks, Ryan.